Recorded Books presents My Life in Dire Straits by John Illsley, narrated by the author, a foreword by Mark Knopfler. And now, My Life in Dire Straits.
We were lucky we weren't teenagers. That would certainly have been fatal. Nearly everything we were to experience in the professional music game was for the first time, so we had to learn as we went at ever-increasing speed through an ever-changing landscape. John had wanted it all as badly as I did. He was a great companion for the trip the band took, and he still continues to be a great mate today. John felt like an old friend from the beginning. Whenever we see one another now, which is often, it feels exactly as it did when we first met. He was a constant support, full of the positive energy and willpower required in a touring and recording outfit. Although Dire Straits received a lot of international attention relatively early, I'm not sure that could happen now. John and I both feel extremely fortunate, and always have. It was the era before downloading and piracy, a time which could support careers in music. Nowadays, recording contracts often don't last for more than an album or two. The music business has become more impatient, less inclined to nurture talent. So there's music and there's the music business, two different things. But mainly, for us, it was a huge adventure and a hell of a ride, with all its comedy, absurdity, exhaustion, madness, and sadness. Like everyone, we had to learn to cope with some of the more negative aspects of the game, but John and I always valued and appreciated the success. I'm reading this in my own recording studio, for example. All the hard work paid off. I know John feels the same. The ride is not for everyone, not for those who can't take the pressures and the pace for whatever reasons. It was a different world, and John has remembered a pretty big chunk of it.
Elbows are on the balcony railing. I'm looking down on the sunset marquee pool, watching a guy spinning his inflatable, nursing his daiquiri, an uneasiness gnawing a little at my guts. My cocktail is different, a heady mix of nerves and exhilaration. I've been living off it for 5 weeks, night after night, coast to coast in the States. But tonight, the whirlwind tour almost done, there's a double shot of nerves in the shaker, two parts nerves to one part exhilaration, with a dash of fatigue and a twist of disbelief. We're playing the Roxy. Neil Young, Frank Zappa, The Temptations, Bob Marley, Van Morrison, Bruce Springsteen, Chuck Berry, Lou Reed, Jimmy Cliff, The Ramones, Patti Smith, Etta James, Jerry Lewis, B.B. King, and tonight, ladies and gentlemen, all the way from London, England, yes, please give it up for Dire Straits. Or in my head at least, please give it up for four lads from the borough of Lewisham. That's how it feels anyhow, not quite believing it's real, and I'm trying to get my head around the absurdity of it, pretend it's just another gig, like the ones we were doing a few months back. It's not a big gig, the Roxy, just a couple of hundred guests, but it's the Roxy. The Roxy, tiny, but in its way, in kudos terms, as big as Madison Square Garden, the Hollywood Bowl, or Wembley. Right below me, southern rock band the Ozark Mountain Daredevils, all bushy beards and long hair, up poolside, slumped on lounges, swilling long-neck beers, bantering with the beautiful Californian babes milling around in their bikinis. A couple of cool dude waiters are floating between the tables, handing out cocktails and clearing the empties. The music is low, but amplified in the intimacy of the pool area, a small courtyard overlooked by two stories of rooms on all sides. The sky over to the west is a deep burnt orange fading to grey, and the outdoor lights come on, silhouetting the miniature palm trees. There's a hand on my shoulder. It's Mark. You all right? Yeah, great. It's just, you know. Yeah, weird. Yeah, weird, all right. A long way from Deptford, that's for sure. Embrace it. We could be in the Dog and Duck, begging for a midweek slot after the darts match. I picture us around our little wooden table, four pints of brown ale, rolling our fags, moaning about the band on the little stage in the corner, labouring through their set of Beatles and Stones tracks, a few old guys on their bar stools, reading the Racing Post. Below me, a guy with an afro is walking to the shallow end, with a beer in one hand and a smoke in the other. Mark says, come on, we've got to go. Reception just called. The limo's here. Limo? This time it felt right. We were in Hollywood, for God's sake. You don't take the bus. We knock at Dave's and Pick's room and make our way down, past the pool, Pick playing the air with his imaginary drumsticks, the real ones sticking out of his back pocket. In one of the reclining Ozarks, a hot beach babe sitting on his lounger, now caressing his chest hair, raises his beer bottle by the neck. Way to go, guys, he smiles. The Roxy, you made it, man. Enjoy. In the air-chilled lobby, the doorman nods and stands aside, pulling open the door to the street. We are back out in the soft, dry heat, making our way down the carpet, under the long golden awning. Spring like autumn barely exists in LA. The temperature hovers between 60 and 70 degrees, and I'm overdressed in my charity shop DJ jacket and heavy Levi's. A smiling chauffeur in his picked cap has the rear door open for us, and we disappear into the huge interior of the shiny black Lincoln, bigger than the kitchen back in Deptford. We pull away, swing left into Sunset Boulevard, downtown Los Angeles behind us, Beverly Hills up ahead. We're all silent, staring out of the windows, taking in Hollywood's neon bar signs, the rollerbladers and the lightly stirring palms. Our second time in a limo in as many weeks. We found out back in London the record company has put them on our bill like breakfast at the Portobello and the sirloins and salt beef in Nassau. A small crowd of a few dozen is hanging outside as the chauffeur eases the limo to the curb. The Roxy looks like a detached family house, minus the stacked logs and plus double swing doors. Right outside, there are two Hell's Angels-style bouncers and a lamppost with a big orange neon R like a giant lollipop planted in the sidewalk between the towering palms. We climb out, a few heads turn our way, and a guy with a boogie box on his shoulder shoots through us on his skateboard, trailing the smell of weed. The owner, Lou Adler, record producer of the Mamas and the Papas and Sam Cooke, greets us in the lobby. Pick playing air drums probably the giveaway that we must be the band he'd booked. You can't mistake Lou in his beret, beard and shades. He's very friendly, and none the worse, it seems, for his recent kidnapping and split from Britt Eklund. We shake hands, thank him for the honour of playing his venue, and yes, we promise to come and find him in the bar after the show. Hey man, no idea you guys were English. That's so cool. The music sounds, you know, American. Rock and roll with a touch of the blues. Mark says in Geordie, yeah, we've had that a lot since we've been here. The dressing room backstage is no bigger than the ones in the village halls back in England, and if we were lucky to get one at all, in the pubs too. We can swing a kitten, but not much more, and we're bumping into each other, cursing and apologising as we get ready, heading out into the open of the passageway to neck a few beers before the guy comes and tells us it's time. The Roxy's full, guys, and it's ready to rock. When we flew out to the States, we were in great shape, tight as a drum skin, not a chord or beat out of place, song after song. You can't hit the road out there unless your performance is at peak fitness. If you're not stage ready, and you're lucky to be playing on the right side of the tracks, they'll groan and shuffle away to the bar. In less courteous places, especially the unis and the hick towns, you'd better have some slick dance moves to avoid the shower of projectiles from the floor. You probably won't see that in the Roxy, but I'd sooner take a hurricane of Bud bottles in Pig's Knuckle, Arkansas, than a glum silence in New Adler's joint. Screw up in the Roxy, and influential people in the music world will soon get to hear you weren't up to much. Get the place jumping, and you never know who will be in the audience any night at the Roxy. And the good news travels fast. These little gigs at iconic venues have a unique atmosphere, and the pressure to perform well was hard to put out of our minds. In front of a small, exclusive audience with big names from the music industry seated below, you really don't want to mess up. We're on the top of our game, roused by the sheer thrill of the experience, and we go straight on stage and into our set, no conferring, and kick off with Down to the Waterline. Sweet Surrender on the Quayside. You remember, we used to run and hide. Chapter 1. The Heart of It. If you were to run a line north to south down the centre of England, then another midway across from east to west, the point of intersection would fall bang on a little town called Market Harbour, or as near as makes no odds. You might even score a direct hit and pinpoint Stonehenge, the very house in which I grew up. It was halfway down Shrewsbury Avenue, a small, close, often unmade road on top of a hill, overlooking the town to the north and, in all other directions, the gentle, rolling, hedge-framed countryside of Leicestershire and Northamptonshire. This is as far from salt water as it's possible to be in the UK, as far from the wide open seas and the world beyond as you can get. It is the heart of Middle England, and for better or for worse, this is the world that shaped who I became, a small world that brought great comfort and security, but a world that made me yearn for the distant shores of somewhere way more exotic. One morning, I was walking with my mother down the high street in Market Harborough, the pavements busy with shoppers, filing in and out of the butchers, the greengrocers, and the ironmongers. I was 9 or 10, so it must have been about 1959. We were going to pick up my father from the Westminster Bank and drive him home in our Vauxhall Wyvern for his lunch. My father had risen to the post of manager, and although we were comfortable, he didn't earn a pot of money. Very few households had more than one car back then, so my mother did this every day of the week, also dropping him off in the morning and picking him up in the evening. The only time she got a break from her role as chauffeurs was when the River Welland broke its banks in the great floods of 1958. For a week or so, my father rowed himself across the dirty swollen waters, looking a little incongruous in his three-piece suit, pipe stuck in the corner of his mouth. Anyhow, that morning we were crossing the street when the whole scene froze, as if zapped by a giant stun gun from the skies. Everyone just stopped, including us, and the traffic, light as it was, slowed sharply. Only one pedestrian was moving, a young man from India or Pakistan. I was transfixed. I'd never seen a brown face, and neither, so it appeared, in anyone else. Had the man been wearing no trousers and a top hat, he couldn't have triggered greater fascination. After a few moments, somebody pressed the play button, the scene moved on, and the world resumed spinning on its axis. In that fleeting, weirdly thrilling moment, the curtain had been yanked back, and I got my first glimpse of the world beyond our sleepy little market town. It wasn't so much the man himself that intrigued me, but the reaction of the locals, the farmers hopping out of their filthy Land Rovers in muddied boots and flat caps, the grannies in knitted bonnets, and the well-to-do housewives in pencil skirts and matching tweed jackets, all frozen to the spot. I can't say for sure it was at that precise moment I set my course on a life more adventurous than the one on offer in Market Harborough, but it was certainly around that time that my imagination began to take flight. Insularity was a state of being for Britons in the 50s, the sight of a foreigner rare as hen's teeth. Most of Market Harborough's population had never set foot in London, let alone journeyed overseas. Only the old soldiers like my father, now in their 30s and 40s, had crossed the water. A trip to Leicester, 18 miles up the road, was a major excursion. To Birmingham, about 60 miles, it was a right old adventure, and to London, 100 miles, it was an epic that people would dine out on for weeks. And for some, a tale even to tell the grandchildren. London might just as well have been Tokyo for the farm workers, bank employees, and shopkeepers of Market Harborough. One evening around the same time, in a rare break with the no-nonsense traditions of her kitchen, my mother put a reputation for good sense on the line and served my father with a curry dish. I was the official veg gatherer from the garden, as well as her sous chef, chopper in chief. I could tell by the smells from her stove that something new and exciting was in the air that evening. My mother, it was obvious, was a little nervous when she laid down the plate of steaming spiced food before him. There was a short silence, then my father slowly picked up his fork, leaned back a little and prodded it, like she'd served him roadkill. "What on earth is this?" he asked, politely bemused, politely horrified even. Like almost every other household in Britain at the time, most evening meals comprised some undressed meat, some potatoes, and one type of vegetable, maybe two, preferably boiled to rags. My mother was a fine cook, but that was the mode du jour. Homemade fish and chips on Friday was the great excitement of the week. The Sunday roast was an event too, but it came with a price, leftovers on Monday. Curry was what people ate during the Raj because they were unable to get hold of minted lamb chops and boiled spuds or sausages and mash. Curry was never seen in a British dining room, and outside the major cities there was not a curry house to be found on any high street. Whether Mum's curry was proof that Britain was on the verge of a great cultural transformation, which it was, or a sign of just how small-minded and conservative we were back then, which we were, I was too young to judge. The fact that I remember these two trivial incidents as significant childhood events tells its own story about the settled, parochial domesticity of British family life in the late 50s. How could we have guessed that British culture was a year or two away from being given a mighty shake-up and left standing on its head. Maybe Mum's exotic, daring curry was the sign, a harbinger of things to come. I don't remember our first house, a small semi-Leicester, because I was 4 years old when Dad borrowed some money from his mother and some from his bank, both at favourable rates of interest, and we moved into Stonehenge, so called, I suppose, because it was built from this warm, golden Northamptonshire stone. It was not the flashiest house on the street by a long stretch, but it was honest and comfortable, with solid oak window frames and even a downstairs loo, which was considered quite fancy in those days. Why we had an outside loo as well, I can't tell you. The garden was just under an acre, large enough to accommodate a veg plot to serve our needs most of the year. There was even room left over for Dad to create a grass tennis court, but one that bore only the faintest resemblance to Wimbledon Centre Court. Take the net away, and it was pretty well indistinguishable from the rest of the grass. It was my task to mow and roll it, and although I took my responsibilities very seriously, the ball never bounced true, forever mocking the players by shooting away at all angles. My two elder siblings got their own bedrooms, Richard, who was 8 years older than me, and my sister, Pat, 5 years older. I shared the fourth bedroom with William, who was just over a year older, near enough to my birthday for me to confront my mum after some kid's jibe in the primary school playground that I had been a mistake. "Of course you're not, darling," she exclaimed. "We were so keen to have you, we couldn't wait any longer." As the fourth child, I wasn't mothered too hard, and under William's protection, I was pretty well left to do what I liked outside school, biking for miles and miles across the country lanes, building rafts on the Welland, fishing for chub in the canal, and in the winter, sledging all day long down our hill and skating on the pond at the bottom. Many memoirs recall terrible childhoods, but I'm afraid I'm unable to lay claim to one. Mine was a happy one, and there's nothing I can do about that. Sure, my parents were strict. I would never have dared defy them or talk back to them, but they were always fair. We weren't churchgoers except at Christmas, and we took communion from time to time, but they instilled in us a very keen sense of what was right and what was wrong. When I was a little older, living in Deptford and very short of cash, I wrote to my dad telling him I was struggling a little and asking if he might help. He sent me 20 quid by return of post with a letter explaining that because he was giving me the money, he was also sending the same sum to my three siblings, even though they were all in employment. He always knew where you stood in Stonehenge. They were loving parents, although in true post-war fashion, the love was never exhibited in words, let alone in public display. Perish the thought. That would have made everyone go red and feel ashamed of their weakness. Like most others of the time, we were not a family given to hugging. Many years later, towards the end of my father's life, I thought, to hell with it, I'm going to give him a hug before he dies. I took a deep breath, but when I stepped forward, Dad's face creased in alarm, and he recoiled as though I'd come at him with a 6-inch blade. But I hugged him anyway. Still, in that repressed, non-verbal, non-tactile English way, we all knew we loved each other. We just never dared say it or show it, no matter how desperate we might have been to give or receive a warm embrace. You didn't build empires by sobbing and hugging one another, after all. I guess that generation, with a Lee Enfield at its head, would say, "Of course we love our children. They know that. It's obvious. But you don't need to harp on about it, for heaven's sake." My father had certainly done his bit for Queen, country and empire. Not that he ever talked to anyone about it, except his old pals from the Royal Signal Corps, one of the first into action to set up battlefield communications. Like any schoolboys fascinated by tales from the war, a mighty war that had ended just 4 years before I was born, I was desperate to know about his experiences fighting across North Africa and up through Sicily and other parts of Italy. Did he ever meet Monty? How close did he get to capturing Rommel? Were the Hun really awful cheats? But he would rarely be drawn. He would just clamp his pipe in his teeth, ruffle my hair and say something like, "Come along now, let's go and finish building your go-kart." It must have been strange for those soldiers, away for so many years, fighting those hideous battles, suffering heaven knows what degree of what we'd call now PTSD. The term wasn't even invented then. They still called it shell shock. But to be diagnosed with it, you virtually had to be naked on all fours, drinking from puddles, before being led away by the men in white coats. My father would have seen some dreadful fighting, given his campaigns, but he never let on about the horrors. I often wonder how he might have suffered. Posted to North Africa early in the conflict, he popped back on leave for a couple of weeks, not to return for 4 years. When he did finally come home, he met his son, my brother Richard, for the first time, a walking, talking son about to go to nursery school. I was about to say that I can't get my head around that, but I can. I ended up doing a half a dozen tours of the world, each one lasting a year or so, roughly the length in total of the Second World War. There were no guns, except in Italy, no deaths, but the absence from home can't have felt any less acute than it had for my father. I never considered my father's anguish, never pictured him sitting in some tedious camp in the rear waiting for orders to go into action. It was only when I went on the road myself, leaving my wife and children at home, that I gave it some thought. You're playing music in front of large audiences, not gunning down Germans and Italians, but it's still a weird and dislocating experience being on the road, detached from that security and homeliness. But more of that later. My father never really escaped the long shadow of the war, his 6 years of combat in distant lands. On demobilizing, he immediately signed up to the Territorial Army, and every summer he'd host a reunion with his old chums in our back garden. Half a dozen men, dressed in their fatigues and berets, would sweep into the drive in their jeeps, set up their field tents, and unload all the impedimenta of war. There were no guns or artillery pieces, which was disappointing, but otherwise, it was a perfect recreation of a proper camp, complete with billy cans and jerry cans, ammo boxes and portable cooking stoves. It was the highlight of the holidays for me, and William and I would sleep out in one of the tents, the comforting stench of damp, musty campus filling our nostrils. The Second World War may have been one of the most momentous events in history, claiming the lives of millions, hastening the end of the British Empire and reshaping the world order. But as soon as hostilities ended for most combatants, ordinary life restarted with barely a moment's reflection. My father was back in post at his bank within 2 weeks of his return, heading off in his three-piece suit after 6 years continuously in his khaki uniform. He was a good man, my father, hard not to respect. Even now, heading into my 70s when faced with a difficulty, I still ask, what would Dad have done? Mum's character was the mirror image of his, thoroughly decent, unflappable, kind, loving, dutiful. Like him, she was Leicestershire born and bred, the daughter of a headmaster. Hers was a life of domestic toil, bringing up 4 kids, all the household chores falling within her brief. She went about it happily enough, as far as I could tell, but I was observant enough to see it was hard graft. She shopped for and cooked all the meals, baked the bread every few days, drove my father to and from the bank 4 times a day, constantly cleaned the house from top to bottom, scrubbed and wrung all our clothes until our first washing machine arrived at the end of the 50s. And with me as a part-time helper, she tended to all the tasks in the garden too. She neither smoked nor drank, unlike her cigar-smoking, gin-loving mother, and her one escape from the rigours of housework was an occasional round of golf down at the club at the foot of the hill. She must have been quite keen, because like Dad, she was the captain there for a few years. The only time my mother got a break from the kitchen was when we travelled up to Ashby de la Zouche to take Granny out for lunch at the Crown Hotel. That was every bit as exciting as it sounds, so miserably formal, the atmosphere so stultified it was no more fun than going to church, and they were excited to make me eat something called smoked salmon, which made me feel sick. Raw orange fish? Otherwise, we never ate out, partly because apart from the bigger hotels, there were very few restaurants to eat out in, and partly because it would have been considered an abominable waste of money. Why shell out a tenner when Mum can cook it just as well at home? There was little culture in our lives. My parents weren't great readers or music lovers, and I don't remember any conversations around the dining table about the arts. That, too, I think was fairly typical of the time. My parents belonged to a practical generation, mending and making do, and getting on with the main business of creating an ordered household in which the children might grow up safe and happy, just as they had done. It came as a surprise then, after their deaths, to learn that my mother, who I knew had a gorgeous singing voice, had joined a choral society, and that, this all, after we had flown the nest, my father turned to painting, just as I was to do later in life too. Clearing out their belongings, we found quite a number of Dad's drawings. and they were really impressive for someone with no formal training. I can't but wonder quite what they, especially my mother, would have done with their lives had they not been so fanatically dutiful in raising the family, putting all their effort, money and time into that, leaving themselves so little to nurture their own gifts and interests. There was nothing glamorous about their lives, but there was something a little heroic in their self-sacrifice and unmovable sense of duty to us. Life probably wasn't a great deal different in Market Harbour to what it had been before the First World War. In 1954, the UK became the last country to end rationing, and within a few years the economy was surging. The boom in consumerism found its greatest expression in technology and gadgetry, whetting the appetite for all things new, and in youngsters like me at least, creating a yearning for modernity, for something different. In 1950, the year after my birth, half of British homes had no bathroom and millions of people shared an outside loo with their neighbours. Homes in remote rural areas had no electricity, food was kept cool in the larder, clothes were washed by hand, most people had a weekly bath and a tin tub, and virtually no one had a car. By the end of the decade, televisions, washing machines, refrigerators, gramophones and vacuum cleaners were filling homes, and most families outside of the cities had a car in the driveway, buffed and polished with pride every weekend. My very first memory, a little before this boom, is watching the Queen's coronation on a television set, bought, like so many others, especially for the occasion. It's a cliche to say it, but this was an impossibly exciting moment for a four-year-old boy. I sat cross-legged on the floor in my shorts, transfixed. The room rammed with neighbours and friends. The little square screen in the corner flickering and fuzzing in shades of grey as Her Majesty made her way down the aisle of Westminster Abbey. It seems laughable now, this lust for a modernity that now seems so quaint. Mum made the most delicious bread, but all I wanted was the slice and processed stuff all the kids were boasting about at primary school, down in the heart of Little Bowden, at the bottom of the hill. When finally I got to try some with baked beans on top, no less, I returned from my mate Mike's across the road, feeling really with it, like I had now truly arrived in the modern world. So too for my mother when the co-op opened, the first self-service shop in Market Harbour. Until then, Mum would tramp from one specialist store to the next, clutching her list, and the shopkeeper would hurry round the shelves, picking out the items desired. The co-op was no less than a revolution. Maybe Market Harbour wasn't such a backwater after all. That was the feeling in town. Who needs London when you've got a co-op? So you get the picture of my childhood. Middle England, middle class, safe, happy and comfortable, but a tad grey, unadventurous and unimaginative. My only exposure to culture was the occasional trip to the pantomime, and most exciting of all, twice to London for the international motor show Earl's Court with Dad, and once to see My Fair Lady. The great highlight of the year was the annual holiday to Cornwall. Weighed down by six passengers and our luggage, it took 12 hours for the Wyvern to crawl the 280 miles to our rented cottage overlooking Trevone Bay. Today that journey takes 5 hours. The car was so heavy that when we reached the Somerset market town of Frome, three of us had to get out and walk so that the Wyvern could make it up the steep hill. My mother and father were expecting me to follow in their path and stick around in lovely, sleepy Leicestershire. Why wouldn't they? What other kind of good life was there? Why leave Market Harbour when it offered everything a young man might want? Pubs, shops, including a co-op, a cinema, beautiful countryside, walks, fishing, a golf club, a rugby club, and if you must, a railway station to take you into Leicester. And there were dozens of pretty and hearty farmers' daughters to settle down with. What on earth does London have to rival such a contented life? All that squalor and pollution and fast women and con men. Then William built himself a crystal radio from a kit, and any hope of me leading a quiet life in rural Leicestershire vanished overnight. Chapter 2. Night Flight to Luxembourg. The crystal radio was a very basic bit of equipment that required no batteries, just a long antennae to pick up signals from nearby transmitters. In our case, that was the big plug-in radio set downstairs. Unlike me, William was born with a gift for fixing and building things, undaunted by any challenge to his resourcefulness. If you gave him all the tools and laid out all the parts, he could probably work out how to build a car. I'm exaggerating only a little. He was so good with his hands, no one was surprised that he ended up becoming a fine sculptor, potter, and painter. He finished assembling the radio kit in no time, and then we waited, all sleepy innocents, for Mum and Dad to put their heads around the door to say goodnight. Once the lights were out and they were safely back downstairs, he pulled his secret contraption from under the bed and plugged in the headphones. This was pretty well the height of mischief for 10 and 11-year-old boys in the late 50s. To listen to American rhythm and blues music when we should have been getting our sleep in for school was to break an unwritten commandment. This degenerate music from across the Atlantic was regarded as seriously damaging to the development of the nation's moral health. In the court of parental opinion, this was William's crime, but I was a willing accessory to it, the lookout. A little nervous, I kept my eyes on the door handle, ready to throw a slipper at William. But hearing the tinny buzz from my bed, I was soon filled with curiosity and envy. I think William must have picked up on my restlessness and excitement, because after a while he said, "Hey, come and listen to this. It's Radio Luxembourg. We'll take it in turns, one song each." He's a good bloke, my big brother. I lay down next to him, both of us staring at the ceiling, and my adventure in music began. Luxembourg was an independent station they were all talking about at his school, playing music you could hear nowhere else at the time. From the moment the sound erupted into my eardrum, it was obvious the songs being played were a very far cry from family favourites, and strictly not for grown-ups, especially ones who smoked pipes and polished their cars in the driveway on Sundays. By the time I crept back to my own bed an hour or two later, I was unable to sleep, my head buzzing with the rasping, rebel voices of Little Richard and Elvis Presley, and heaven knows who else. I've tried to explain the utter heart-thumping thrill of that moment to my children, who are plugged into their music of choice all day long. It's very hard for anyone born after 1960 to understand there was ever a world of virtually no media, least of all for the younger generation, no connection to a world beyond the playground, the street and the fields in which you played. Until I was about 10, the Eagle comic, Children's Hour on the radio at 5 o'clock, featuring Dick Barton's special agent and family favourites. These were the frontiers of fun for a British child inside the home. On family favourites, mums, dads and the kids sat around the house radio and rang in their song requests. Most of the tunes played were crooning love ballads and big band jazz, the kind of music that has young boys and girls staring at the clock, wondering when they might be released to go and do something fun, like build an Airfix model aeroplane. Tommy Steele and Max Bygraves were about as funky as it got. In the mid to late 50s, Lonnie Donegan, the King of Skiffle, was probably the coolest and most original act in Britain, with great appeal among the younger audience. But even he would have been considered far too racy for family favourites. That was until Cliff Richard and his backing band, The Shadows, turned upon the scene with Move It, probably the best rock and roll song ever to come out of Britain. I'm serious. It was so good, so raw, that the older generation was seriously worried by its shameless lustfulness. All that sexual lip curling and hip swaying. It's a cracking piece of music, and it's a great shame that very soon after its release and the minor scandal it triggered, Cliff retreated from the edge and took the safer part so readily. The Shadows were a highly talented band, and guitarist Hank Marvin, one of the greats. The BBC was very much part of the traditional establishment, the voice of the older generation, and by far the most powerful cultural influencer of the day. The corporation's efforts to thwart the young by controlling their tastes, feeding them homely and harmless fare, and shielding them from dangerous American trends, were soon to prove futile. If anything, their effort to control and brainwash kids into liking the same music as Mummy and Daddy fueled a powerful counterculture, as represented by Radio Luxembourg. What was emerging in the late 50s and early 60s, with the kids plugged into their little radio sets after the curfew, a few years down the line was going to lead to the unchaining of youth culture and a wild reinvention of popular music. Everything that the powers at the BBC and the wider establishment feared most. The television wasn't much more exciting than BBC radio once the space age thrill of it had worn off. For a start, it only had two channels, BBC and ITV. And most of the programming was aimed at an adult audience, the schedule full of cookery programs, Hancock's Half Hour, and westerns. The fate of the music program 6-5 Special was proof that the BBC was hostile to catering for the tastes of the young. When it was launched early in 1957, It enjoyed instant success and was watched by millions. But the men in suits found all that swaying and strumming less appealing and soon began to interfere, putting pressure on producer Jack Good to include educational and information elements to the show. Good resigned in protest after a year, and when ITV produced their own music show, Oh Boy, playing non-stop music as Good had wanted, the ratings for 6-5 Special plunged, and the BBC pulled the plug on the programme at the end of 1958, making the disingenuous claim that its fall in popularity vindicated their decision. With the BBC seen as the moral authority over culture, television was still regarded in many middle-class households as mildly corrupting, especially ITV, with its vulgar game shows. I was never allowed to watch ITV, the other channel, and I was strictly banned from watching Coronation Street because the characters didn't speak properly. Like most kids, I lived in a bubble, a perfectly happy bubble, but a very small one, in which most of the fun stopped as soon as I was called in from outside to get washed up for supper. But Will's tinny little radio, the cheapest of all gadgets, changed all that, wiping out the boundaries of my imagination and allowing me to dream. Until that night, I used to save up my pocket money for a bag of sweets, a comet like Eagle or Victor, or maybe a new Matchbox car. Now all I wanted was a radio and some headphones of my own. I took on as many chores in the garden and around the house as my mother could find for me, and in a few weeks, I was the proud owner of my own. My parents were fine about Will and me listening to the radio during the evenings, possibly because it freed up the television for them, but they trusted us to switch them off at night. I'm afraid we failed there. We'd head off to school, puffy-eyed and foggy-headed. That crystal radio might well explain why I was no scholar. The signal was not the most reliable, and I spent a fair amount of time walking around the bedroom or dozing off in the corner in an effort to get it back. The radio became my portal into another dimension, a secret door to open every night that would allow me to float away into a fantasy world, whisking me from my bedroom in the English Shires across the Atlantic and into the more vibrant and colourful world of the United States. It was a world constructed in my mind in sound and voices, not in visuals, because there were very few images of the place in circulation, no media to convey them. Watching Gunsmoke hardly gave you an insight into the life of ordinary Americans. My impressions of the country were built on the songs I heard coming out of that little radio set. I was never going to stay and settle down in Leicestershire. Radio Luxembourg had put an emphatic end to that possibility. Rock music? Rhythm and blues? The new popular music? Beat music? No one really knew what to call the new sounds emerging. They only knew that they were not jazz, not folk, not ballads, not big band, not even rock and roll. Because by 1958, the Teddy Boys had cleared off, and that revolutionary movement had already passed. These were new sounds, in search of an identity and an audience, and they found a very willing one in me and Will, and in virtually everyone under the age of about 20. There was nothing unique about my experience, far from it. We were part of a huge nationwide movement. We just didn't know it yet. We were biding our time in our bedrooms. This is possibly going to sound far-fetched, but I've always believed it to be true. Pop music, rock music, whatever you want to call it, filled the great emotional void in young people's lives at a time when it was frowned upon to express emotion. This natural urgency to connect, to express yourself, may have even been the main driving force behind everything that was unleashed in the 60s. In the 50s, housewives might dab an eye listening to Dean Martin or Frank Sinatra, but no one talked openly about love or the longing for it. That was considered unseemly or wet and weak, shameful even. And God forbid any talk of sex, not a chance. Yet our generation was no different emotionally to any that had come before it or after. The parents tapped their feet and hummed along to Perry Como, Doris Day and Pat Boone, concerned not to let their feelings carry them away too far. But for me, certainly listening to American music on the sly and then openly and loudly in my bedroom, I felt as if I was giving license to my feelings, setting them free, being true to myself. It felt right allowing the music and the emotions expressed to talk directly to me. Music was emotional rescue. Today when I hear a track like That's All Right Mama from Elvis' Sun Sessions, it carries me straight back to my bedroom in Market Harbour. The music went deep, and it stayed deep, lodged in there for good. My reaction to the music lying in my bed was intensely physical. I was quite literally shaken and shivered by it. The next day, bouncing down the hill to school with my satchel swinging, it was still resonating and buzzing. The feeling I get when I play live today is almost exactly the same. It was as if someone had put a syringe in my arm and injected me with a very powerful stimulant. I believe recent scientific research has shown that roughly half of us respond to music in this extremely physical way. It is probably the reason why The Who, The Rolling Stones and Elton John announce a new farewell tour every few years. Why once successful but now forgotten bands will play the pub and small club circuit for peanuts and a pint of beer. They need the hit. After a couple of years of furtive radio listening under the covers, the invention of cheap gramophones allowed Will and me to upgrade our musical experience. We no longer had to wait all night for Pete Murray or Fluff Freeman to play our favourite music on Luxembourg. We could go and buy it and listen to it over and over. Until the Beatles took off in 1963, it was very hard to get hold of vinyl, most records being imported from the States, and there being so few record shops in those days, and so it was very exciting to get your hands on one. People treasured their vinyl and took great pride in their collections. The bigger the collection, the higher your status. We bought a Dansette Popular with four speeds, the most common record player of the time, and retailing at an eye-watering 11 guineas. That's roughly 200 quid in today's money. At first, it was only the singles we were interested in, the 7-inch 45 RPMs, and as soon as Will had saved up enough after Cinema Club on Saturday mornings, we'd head down to Green's, the only music shop in Market Harbour. Age 12, I didn't have the earning power to splash out just over 6 shillings on a single, about a fiver in today's money. So the first records were all Will's. But that didn't stop me hearing out of the school gates and up the hill to listen to his latest purchases before he got home. I'd stack them on top of each other and lie on my bed waiting for the satisfying clunk of the vinyl, the click of the needle as they dropped down onto the turntable one after another. The first single of my own was the Beatles' second release, Please Please Me. It took time and a great many household chores, but our collection soon began to grow, and I still have many of them today, my name or Will's written in the corner of the plain sleeve. Fairly quickly, it became clear that listening to the music was not enough. I wanted to play it. The guitar was the instrument that was changing music so rapidly and radically, and I wanted one badly. Trouble was, they were mighty expensive. Word in the playground was that the only affordable one was the Rossetti Lucky 7, but even that was about £10, a vast amount of money, the equivalent of a skilled worker's weekly wage. It took me months and months to save up my weekly 2 shillings and 6 pence pocket money while working like a demon in the garden, cutting grass, digging potatoes and helping Dad clean the wyvern. I bought no comics, no sweets, no fizzy pop, and finally I was able to walk into Green's one Saturday morning, hand over the wadge of cash and place my order. Most guitars back then were American, expensive to import, but Rossetti was a UK distributor, selling instruments manufactured in the Netherlands. The Lucky 7 was the budget option. It was a beast of a guitar, but I wasn't to discover that until a few years later when I got my fingers on a half-decent one. Will had an acoustic of his own, and soon we were picking away at the strings, trying to replicate the sounds of Elvis, the Beatles, and a young folk singer called Bob Dylan. Our parents probably thought the guitar was the instrument of the devil, but they feigned indifference. Happy, I guess, that at least we were learning to play an instrument and not smoking cigarettes down by the railway tracks, although we did that as well. We had a basic chord book and some sheet music, and once I had mastered where to put my fingers, Will showed me some simple chords on his acoustic, starting with the 3 basic blues ones, E, A, and B. I found it very hard, but I persevered for hour after hour, barely emerging from my room all day in the holidays and at weekends, at first going from E to A, then from A to E, then expanding the repertoire till my fingers hurt and my brain was fried. You have to really want to learn to play the guitar, or any instrument. It's why there are so many barely used guitars lying around the world's bedrooms, attics and basements. It takes endless practice to break through and get to the stage where it becomes automatic and you're not thinking about it, just feeling it. So it was some time, a couple of months probably, before I felt ready to attempt a song. I laid out the sheet music, put on the simplest record in our collection, and inflicting a terrible assault on the song's integrity, tried to join in. It was thrilling to nail a few chords, but frustrating when I stumbled and the song got away from me. But I kept at it, and I kept working on new chord structures too. Combinations of C, G, F, A minor. It was a full year before I had most of them in the bag. It was a revelation and a relief to discover that if you know about 12 chords, you can play a lot of songs. How well you play them is another matter, but once you start messing around with chords, you never stop. Even today, almost 60 years on, if I see my guitar leaning against the wall and I have 5 minutes to kill, I pick it up and start strumming, just as I did in my bedroom all those years ago. The basic chords cracked. Playing became an obsession, to the exclusion of all else. I abandoned the sheet music and played along to the records. That's not an especially impressive achievement, because most early rock songs are very simple arrangements. And Dylan songs, like Blowing in the Wind, for example, are so beautifully uncomplicated they're almost like children's nursery rhymes. The sheet music was more hindrance than help, because it always seemed to lag behind the record, particularly with the Beatles tracks. Years later, I was to learn this was because when the tracks were recorded, the engineers had speeded them up a touch to give them a little more verve. The Vizzetti Lucky 7 was a very crude instrument, but it was probably a good thing that I had to learn the craft the hard way. Both Keith Richards and George Harrison also learned to play on a Vizzetti, and for that reason alone, it deserves an honourable mention in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Will and I would pore over the latest guitar magazines, gazing longingly at the Gibsons, Rickenbackers, Martins and Fenders. All we might be able to afford was Watkins Rapier, but without an amp, that was never under consideration either. When I upgraded to a half-decent Hofner, I was delighted to discover that not all guitars are born or built equal. It was like getting behind the wheel of a Merc after passing my test in a Reliant Robin. For 2 years, the Lucky Seven and I were joined at the hip, and I will always have a soft spot for my first guitar. When I wasn't sleeping or in the classroom, I was sitting on my bed staring out over the rolling hills of the Leicestershire countryside, battling through the chords, trying to keep up with my new heroes and idols, indulging in the fantasy of being there alongside them on that stage or in the studio. Some kids dreamed of scoring the winning goal at Wembley in the FA Cup final. I dreamed of being in a band, but not for a moment did I ever think it would become a reality. My immediate reality, that I was going away to boarding school, a very old-fashioned English boarding school at that, was more in tune with the age of Queen Victoria and the world of Gilbert and Sullivan than the new Elizabethan age and the world of Elvis and the Beatles. Chapter 3. Banjos, beatings, and bass. Will came back for the Christmas holidays after his first term at boarding school, full of stories of bullying, flogging, and fagging, the time-honored tradition of a new boy acting as a slave to a senior. The school prefects at Bromsgrove were known as Jouts, he said, which immediately made me think of the orcs in The Lord of the Rings, the Tolkien trilogy everyone was reading at the time. The Jouts sounded equally as fearsome as the orcs, apparently finding any excuse to reprimand, punish, and even beat a junior for the most minor infraction of the rules. Just stepping off the path onto the corner of the immaculate manicured lawn led to a heavy cuff over the head and an hour in detention or a summary boot in the pants, even a full thrashing from the most belligerent prefects. It sounded terrifying, and I was going to be joining him there the following year. I'd been looking forward to Will coming home so much it felt as if he had been away for years, but it was only 3 months. I found it hard being the only child left behind in our once full and happily noisy household. Richard and Pat were now working full-time, Richard for the Royal Insurance Company and Pat as PA to the boss at Walker's Crisps down the road in Market Harbour. Will had been my constant companion, roommate, fellow explorer of the Leicestershire wilds, and above all, maybe, my musical mentor. Now, I'd only get to see him in the holidays, and I felt an aching sadness looking over at his empty bed, his blankets and eiderdown neatly folded into squares at his foot. Yearning for company, I spent a lot of time on Dad's ancient sit-up and beg bike cycling to villages as far as 10 miles away over the hills and along the twisting narrow lanes, just to spend an hour or two with a mate from school. One of them lived in the little hamlet of Terlangton, and I was happy to make the long round trip, whatever the weather. We'd sit in the nearby hay barn, smoking the woodbines he'd nicked from his father's pub, the Crown Inn. I didn't like smoking one bit, and I was sick the first few times, but it was something to do, a naughty thrill to break the tedium of my weekends. It wouldn't be long before I overcame my disgust for cigarettes and became a proper smoker, like most teenagers of the time. But at first I did it just for the hell of it, not to be moping around in an empty house. After primary school in Little Bowden, I'd moved to Brook House, a little prep school in Market Harbour. The idea behind it, as with all preparatory schools, being to prepare the child for the rigours of boarding school. But unlike the impression Will had painted of Bromsgrove, Brook House was a happy place, and I enjoyed it, though my memories of it a bit hazy. Two of the teachers made a big impression, a sexy young French teacher, all the way from France itself, who we all fancied rotten, and a very elderly English master who had a yellow face from being gassed in the Great War. He was a very good teacher, who inspired me to read a great deal more, and we were always delighted, as well as astonished, when he made it to the end of the class without dying. He read us our Wordsworth and Tennyson as if every wheezing breath might be his last. My best friend was Willie Gilbertson, the most rebellious boy in the school. He only lived a few miles away, but he became a boarder when his parents could no longer tolerate his anarchy at home. He wasn't a lot more law-abiding at school, in spite of the strict discipline, causing a great scandal when, after a row with the headmaster, he dismantled his metal bed and hurled it from the first-story window, badly damaging the French teacher's Austin Metropolitan. Despite a general sense of well-being, my principal memory of Brook House is an unhappy one. During break one day, the headmaster's crazy sheepdog managed to escape and came bounding and slobbering across the playground in search of prey. He had plenty of appetizing options, all those bare legs and shorts like raw legs of lamb, but he decided that my flesh looked the juiciest and sunk his gnashes into my calf. It was such a deep bite, I had to go to hospital and have a dozen stitches and a tetanus jab. The dog was immediately taken away and put down. No one was there then, and I felt a little guilty, sad, that the dog had paid the ultimate penalty for what was probably no more than the same hijinks in which we had been indulging in the playground. This wasn't my first trip to hospital. I was quite an accident-prone kid. Playing in the garden one afternoon, aged 4, I dropped a paving stub on my foot and spent 2 nights in an empty ward at the Leicester Royal Infirmary, down in town. It was the first time I'd been away from home, and the misery of it was so great it played on my mind for years after and made me dread the day I'd have to leave the comforts of Stonehenge and go away to school like my elder siblings. On another occasion, in a really dumb attempt to get my parents to buy me a proper bike, I worked up as much speed as I could and crashed Dad's rusting hulk into a heavy gatepost. I suffered heavy bruising and cuts and was lucky not to break a bone. My cunning plan didn't work either. Dad just bought a new front wheel. Christ, I must have been bored. I was aimless and lonely at home, so music came to play an even bigger role in my life, and I spent every evening and much of the weekends up in my room, stacking up the singles on the dance set and playing along on my crappy Rossetti Lucky 7, kidding myself I was Little Richard. When the day finally arrived and my heavy trunk was lifted into the back of the Wyvern, I was a boiling pot of conflicting emotions as we drove the 90 minutes through an ice age landscape to Bromsgrove, halfway between Worcester and Birmingham. Part of me was eager for an adventure, to grow up and get on with life, and I was also looking forward to the company of other kids. The other part of me was chilled to the bone with fears of what lay in store, a shivering fear not helped by the sub-zero temperatures getting the better of the car's heating system in the savage winter of 1963. To a 13-year-old, 18-year-olds might just as well be 30 or 40, and I wasn't relishing the prospect of falling foul of their officially sanctioned discipline and unchecked bullying. We were to be the last generation to experience an English boarding school as our great-grandfathers had. Change was in the air, and very soon these schools would start to become more liberal and humane, little by little. It was January 1963 when I started at Bromsgrove, but the experiences that awaited me were little different to those of a young boy there in 1883. I was also sad to be leaving Stonehenge, where I had felt so happy and secure for 10 years. It was a very anxious and timid boy my parents left standing in the snow on the steps of Broom House, watching the Wyvern slip and slide its way down the drive to the school gates, back to the carpeted comfort and centrally heated warmth of home. The winter of 1962-63 remains one of the coldest ever recorded. From just after Christmas through to Easter, the whole country lay under a deep blanket of snow, many of the more remote lanes remaining impassable for the entire period. 4 feet of the stuff lay across the Bromsgrove grounds, and piles twice as high towered like prison walls where it had been cleared along the drives and squares. To walk to the main school was to pass through a long, icy corridor, and even I, very tall for my age, wasn't able to see over the top. Except for a small coal fire in the housemaster's study, there was no heating in Broomhouse, and the housemaster being something of a sadist, there was no chance of us boys being allowed in to share the warmth. Far from it. At lights out in the bedder, our dormitory, he'd stroll in and open every window as wide as it would go.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.